2-2. Swing and a miss. Struck him out on a curveball. First pitch to Judge. Did he hold up on the breaking ball? He did, says Mark Carlson. Swing and a miss. Back-to-back curveballs. Nothing at two. Here's the 0-2. Swing and a miss. Judge goes down on the curveball. Three straight pitches to get Aaron Judge. 0-2. Swing and a miss. Gregorius down on strikes. One away in the ninth. Fifth strikeout for Mccullers. Pitch on the way. Swing and a miss. Sanchez down on strikes. And the Yankees are down to their final out. The 2-0. And Bird skies this one. Shallow center. Correa out. Springer in.
I had a dream I could buy my way to heaven. When I awoke, I spent that on a necklace.
Welcome back to the Batter's Eye Podcast. I'm Aiden. We're here with Max, and we got a huge guest on the podcast today. I mean, take a minute to introduce yourself, talk about yourself a little bit.
Oh, my name is Lance Mccullers, pitcher for the Houston Astros. This is my eighth big league season. 28 years old, born and raised in Tampa, Florida, and, you know, very blessed. Mm-hmm.
Max, go ahead.
Yeah, so first, I want to say, like, I was a little upset that I didn't get to meet with the stadium, as I know you met Aiden with yeah. Dan, but, you know, it all worked out in the end. You know, you're on the podcast, but this doesn't really seem like real to me. Like, I remember 13-year-old me, 2017. First of all, I'm a big Yankee fan.
I can tell. Crying. I see Garrett back there.
Yeah, crying all night because Game 7, you know, you shut down us. So I think it was like a Greg Bird fly off the center. I still have the picture of Springer with his arms up and whatever. You know, the last thing I want to do is bring back bad memories, but I really want to know, like, what it felt like getting that final out. Like, can you, like, relive that for us a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, that was a cool moment for me. I mean, that year and the first half of the season, I made the All-Star team. And was having a really, just really, really good year. And then I was having some back problems. Tried to pitch through them for quite a while in the second half of the season. Really pitched terribly for quite a few starts in a row. And so, you know, pretty much the whole second half of the season in 2017, really struggling just to really get anything going. I mean, 2, 3, 4 innings, my outings were. A lot of runs, you know, then I go on the DL and I came back very late September. So I didn't really know what my role was going to be that postseason. I didn't know how much, you know, they were or weren't going to rely on me. Didn't pitch much in the DS, but then ultimately ended up by starting a game in New York. I think it may have been game 4 or 5, something like that in New York. It was probably game 4. We had the lead. I pitched really well. Kind of started getting some of my mojo back, you know, during that series. My back was finally healthy. I was feeling good. And then game 7 comes up, and I actually told AJ Hinch, I went into his office after the game and I told him I wanted to start game 7 on short rest because I had pitched really well against the Yankees earlier that season in New York, and then ultimately again in the postseason. I said, listen, you know, I really want to start game 7. I know I'm on short rest, but I feel good. I want the ball. And he said, you know, go home and we'll make our decision. So he actually called me. I pulled into my driveway and he called me and he's like, hey, listen, we're going to start Charlie, but you're going to be in the pen and at your first out. We want it to be you and Charlie to go the whole game. Our bullpen was a little bit beat up. That type of thing. So he said, you know, we really want you and Charlie to piece together and try to go the whole game. So be ready. And so really from that night, when I got home, I was just like ready to get up and go to the stadium again. It was a night game. So like all day, I just wanted to go to the field. So I got to the field and was in the bullpen, just watching the whole game. And the atmosphere was crazy. The Yankees had an amazing team that season. And, you know, Charlie went 5 and I'm warming up and we were only up by 1. And our bullpen coach, CB, was like, all right, man, like you're in and like, it's your game. And I think we ended up by scoring a couple more runs. So I came in the game, I think maybe 3-0, 4-0. And, that was the game that I infamously threw like 24 curveballs in a row to close that ALCS game seven. But when you're in those moments, like you're not, I mean, I don't know about other people. I mean, at least for me, it's like, I'm not sitting there saying like, man, this is like ALCS game seven. For me, it's just like, those are the moments that you just kind of like test yourself, kind of like see what you're made out of. And, you know, it was a good night for me and, probably one of my peaks for sure. That was a peak moment for me in my career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I sort of want to get into that a little bit more, the 24 straight curveballs. I mean, I pitched myself, and even just watching games all day, I've never seen anything like it. So I want to know, like, if you had any like scouting before, or did you just, it was just off the fly, you just decided to just keep throwing a curve?
I've told a couple of people this because people ask me, and it was funny because I can't remember exactly like the sequence of the batter, but I think it was to end the seventh. I ended up by striking out. I believe it was, you'll have to go back and look, but I forget who I was facing, but I ended up by leaving the seventh and I struck him out on a curveball and I kind of tweaked my hip a little bit. I landed awkwardly with my front hip. I landed like with my foot kind of sideways and I kind of like jammed up my left hip. So I'm in the tunnel and I'm getting like stretched on and worked on. Our trainer's down there, like, you know, trying to work out my hip and trying to pull it in and out of the socket, seeing if it we can get to free up. And like I said, I had back problems that year. So it was a little bit concerning. One second, guys, the guys here.
Sorry.
Basically like I ended that seventh inning. I believe, I think I struck out Castro on like a curveball. And I went into the tunnel in between innings and my hip, I kind of like jammed my hip up because I landed awkwardly on my front left leg. And, you know, my trainer was working on it and I had a back problems earlier that year. So they were kind of concerned, like, is this a back problem thing or did I just land awkwardly? Like, what's going on? And so I was like, listen, I'm fine. Like, it's no problem. So I go back out to warm up for that next inning and I'm warming up, man. And I'm like, oh, my hip is killing me. I was like, I really should probably come out of the game. But, you know, like AJ had told me, like, we're short in the pen, you know, and I really was like, no, I can't come out of this game. So the first batter, I ended by walking, first batter of the next inning. Like I said, I can't remember who it was. Maybe, may have been Headley or may have been Gardner, but I ended by walking a lefty to start that eighth inning.
So Hicks.
And who was it?
Hicks.
Oh, it was Hicks?
Yeah. So the order, so if it was Castro, then you had Hicks, Frazier, Headley, and then Gardner to that eighth inning.
Okay. Well, whatever the sequence was, I walked someone, I believe, in the eighth, mm-hmm. and Brian McCann came out to the mound and was like, hey man, like, you okay? Like, that whole sequence looked weird. It looked off. And I was like, man, my hip, bro, like, it's just killing me. And I had thrown a bunch of heaters that last at bat. So he was like, hey, just try to like throw in a curveball here, like, see how it feels. And so I threw the curveball and I kind of like fell off like to the left more than I normally would. And the hip didn't bother me. And so the next pitch was curveball. And the next pitch was curveball. And then I was just like, all right, screw it. I guess I'm just going to keep throwing curveballs because like the hip's not bothering me. And I feel like I'm getting through it well. And I feel like, you know, in those moments, you have to understand, like, the Yankees were down by three, I believe, maybe four, whatever the score was. And as the outs start chipping away, the pressure in the other dugout is starting to build, right? And there's no tomorrow. Like, this is game seven. Like, we lose, we go home. So as the outs are starting to fall and the innings are going on, the pressure for them is starting to build. So like each guy coming up to the plate is like trying to get something going. So I'm just throwing curveballs and the guys from the other team, the Yankees, they're trying to like muster some rally, get a knock, you know, big swing, hit a double, maybe hit a solo homer, kind of like get the boys going in the dugout type of thing, because the energy starts to get sucked out of the dugout. Yeah. I've been on the other side of it where it's like you're in the dugout and you're in a big postseason game and the other team, you can just feel like that energy. You can just feel like today's probably not the day. So I think that helped the curveball situation because they were basically in survival mode at that point, and I just continually were throwing breaking ball after breaking ball after breaking ball. And as a hitter, you're probably thinking like, we can't keep just throwing breaking balls. He's got to throw a heater at some point. And that's kind of how the story goes, man. And, you know, the rest is kind of history, but yeah, I started throwing the curveball. You know, I guess consistently after that because the hip was bothering me and that pitch wasn't bothering it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so I talked with you a little bit about this when we met up at the field, but it was game, I think it was game four. You came out in that game and you remembered it better than I did because I remember we talked about it, but you retired 18 straight to start the game. And then in the top of the seven, Judge hits a solo shot off of you. And that was, I think that was your game. I think Hinch took you out after that, but talk about like what was that like to go in at Yankee Stadium? Pressure is at an all-time high. I think it might've been a 2-1 series for the Yankees at that point in this series. And you guys had to even it up. You're on the mound at a packed house at Yankee Stadium, and you go out there and completely shove 16 straight up and down. What's that like?
I think we were actually up 2-1. Yeah. So I think we won both games in Houston on walk-offs. I think Carlos hit a walk-off against Chapman into the gap. And there was a couple other things that happened. But I think we went to New York up 2-0. Mm-hmm. And then we lost the first game because Todd Frazier hit a backside granny off of Morton.
Yep.
And then I went to pitch that game. So that's like a pivotal game, right? Because you're on the road, you know, the Yankees play so good at home, the fans, you know, the whole thing, Yankee Stadium. But for me, you know, the way I was raised, like the way my pops raised me was, you know, is just like, be fearless. You know, it's not like one of those things, whoa, you know, I'm not scared. No, of course, like you're facing the Yankees in their stadium, you know, in a packed house, the fans are, let's just call them passionate for the Yankees. You know, it's a little bit of a nerve-wracking feeling, right? But also on that same like mindset, it's like, I'm not afraid to fail. It's like, if I don't pitch well, if I fail, like I'm going to feel bad. It's going to suck, but like I'll have another shot. Like there's going to be more opportunities. Like there's going to be, you know, I would rather go into a game fearless. And what I mean by fearless is like not afraid to fail, like not afraid of failure versus like, oh, I don't care about the situation. It's like, no, like every situation plays a role. It's just, I'm not afraid to fail. So if I'm going in that situation, not afraid to fail, I'm giving myself the best chance to succeed. And if I do fail, because I left it all out there, I was balls to the walls, I can go to sleep, right? But if I go out there timid or nervous or like, then I pitch poorly, then it's like, I didn't give myself the best chance. Like I didn't allow me to even have a chance to perform well for my team. So that's kind of like my mindset. It's like, the situation is nerve wracking. Like when I pitched last year in LA for the first time since the cheating scandal, I was the first game back and I had actually asked Dusty to pitch that game like months before. Like we saw the schedule come out and I told Dusty, I was like, hey, I want to pitch that first game in LA. I knew it was going to be tough, you know, and for sure, like if you're warming up in the bullpen, it's like, it's a little nerve wracking. Like there's a lot of people screaming at you. Like, you know, you're getting booed, you know, all the way from the hotel, cars are driving by the bus, flipping you off. You feel like, you know, it's a little bit nervous, but it's at the same time, it's like, you're not afraid to like fail in those moments. And it's like a measuring stick. It's like, you know, how good can I be today, especially on the other side of enemy lines. So pitching in that moment was just a cool thing for me. Cause I actually grew up a Yankees fan. My dad played for the Yankees for a couple of years in like late 80s. And I grew up in Tampa, Florida and went to countless spring training games. And my favorite player growing up was Robinson Cano and Mike Mussina. So it's like, I'm a big Yankee fan and it was cool for me in that moment to pitch in that stadium. And I threw a bad curveball to Judge 0-0 to lead off the seventh. Really bad pitch and he hit a homer and AJ took me out. And unfortunately, you know, the Yankees came back, but it was a good game.
Yeah. Good job.
Yeah. And just to like build off of that, but like your mindset, you know, as a Yankee fan myself, obviously I might have booed for you guys the last couple of years, not going to lie. But sometimes I'm like sitting in the stadium and it's like a Yankees Rays game. And next thing you know, everyone starts chanting about the Astros. And I'm like, yeah, I think people need to calm down a little bit. But
everybody needs someone to hate.
Yeah. Yeah. But 2021, like arguably your best year. Do you build off the energy? Do you like feed off the energy of the fans all like, you know, heckling you? And do you think that she helps you pitch, or sometimes you think it gets into your head a little bit?
Well, I think it can go, you know, one of two ways. You know, I think if you're like really concerned about You know, I think for me, I'm at the beginning, I'm very blessed. I'm very lucky. You know, I have a great wife. I have a healthy 2.5-year-old daughter. I got my pups. You know, I have my mom and dad are still around. My grandparents are still around. I have two younger brothers. You know, I have a very good support system, and I'm very confident in just like me as like a person, right? I just am very content like with where I am, and I know I have people like love and support me. So going into these moments, it's like I know people are gonna boo us and things like that, but just the mindset of like not being afraid, like to walk into those moments and just put my best foot forward, even though like this, like the crowd may be like a little, rambunctious or maybe like a hostile like environment, going out there, like not afraid of what the end result is going to be, and kind of using it as like a measuring stick. Like I really felt like when I went to LA last year and I pitched and I had that game that I pitched there, against that team, against Bueller, you know, Walker Bueller, especially, I went toe to toe with them type of thing. I really kind of felt like I was like a big time big leaguer, so to speak. So I think those moments are a great measuring stick. Like I mentioned, it's just fun to like really go out there and like test yourself and like see like what you're truly made of. Cause like everyone likes to think of themselves in a certain light. And I think those moments get to test you and really show you, like where you are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there's just one thing I want to ask, cause I don't know how it works really, but you come out on the schedule and you're saying you ask for some of these games. How often do you really find yourself in that position where it's like, I know I want to pitch this game and I want to ask that? Is that like a special once a season kind of
thing? Yeah, that's not very often. I mean, that was probably one of the only games I've like gone to like my manager, my career. And obviously other than like the postseason, like things like that, like last year, it was funny. Last year we got rained out in, it's kind of like the mindset that I think people like should have. Like we got rained out in, Chicago in the postseason, and they called me into the office and they were like, "Hey, how you feeling? Like, you know, you're on a day less rest. You know, we really like to close the game out." It was very hostile in Chicago, huge crowd the night before, you know, very loud. You know, they won big, they had some momentum. They're like, "Hey, like, you know, do you want to come back and pitch like a day early?" And I was like, "Hell yeah, I want to pitch." And so I left the office, and I was like doing my warm up. I was like doing my preparation, and I noticed that Dusty did his press conference and like hadn't mentioned who was pitching. And so I go, "Yo, Dusty, what's up, bro? Like, why didn't you tell him I was pitching?" He goes, "Oh man, I don't want to let him know." And I was like, "Why?" He's like, "Oh, you know, gotta play the game. I'm like, "Nah, man." I was like, "Let them know I'm coming. Like, tell them, like, tell the media, like I'm pitching, so they can send the text out, like, 'Hey, Mccullers is pitching tomorrow,' type thing." And then like, maybe it doesn't matter at all to like people, but sometimes I've had good success against Chicago that season and in the past. So maybe that text, like, "Hey, he's definitely pitching tomorrow," we'll throw him off, or, you know, stuff like that. So, you know, going into that LA game months before, I just kind of put my finger on the schedule. It was coming after the All-Star break, so I thought we'd be able to adjust it a little bit. And I felt like I'm the only guy on the staff that was part of that team, and I shouldn't have to make like somebody else go out there on that first time, which is going to be like pretty tough. Like It should be me. So that was kind of the moment. That was kind of the only time I've ever asked for it.
Yeah. And that's obviously, I feel like that's a good mindset to have, because I see how people react and fans react so passionately. Like you're talking about Yankee fans, but especially the Dodger fans, because that was the World Series team for them. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of stuff that comes with that, especially, you know, losing in that championship kind of atmosphere and what happens after it. I just find it insane that this grudge isn't going to end against the Astros. Like, I feel like at this
point, it's okay.
I mean, it fuels you, you think?
No, I mean, I kind of feel like if we were on the other side, like, I don't think I would want to let it go. You know, I don't think like I would like, they won a World Series. So I think it softens the blow a little bit, but like if they wouldn't have had one yet, you know, maybe, but at the same time, it's like, you know, I'll stand on this. It's like, you know, what we did like was wrong, but like, we weren't cheating in the postseason. I know people like don't want to like acknowledge that, but, it just is what it is, but it doesn't matter. Like what we did was wrong. Like we did it and, you know, we've had to pay the price and we've come out the other side. We're still a fantastic team. We have a chance to go to the ALCS again, chance to make another World Series run. And, you know, we'd be the only team to do it 6 times in a row. And when you include like, well, like the adversity that we've had to deal with, even though a little bit self-inflicted, right? A lot of guys on our team, actually most of the guys weren't even in our organization. It's like, I think the Yankees may employ more like Astros from the 2017 team or like organization than we have anymore. Like you got Beltran in the booth, you got Cameron Maben in the booth, you got Marvin Gonzalez on the team, you got a couple of our coaches and coordinators now that like work for the Yankees in the minor league system, like or in their analytical department. So it's like most of the people we have on the team weren't even part of that team. And if anything, our rival teams now employ more people from that team than we do. So it just, at the end of the day, it's something for people to, you know, hang on to. And there has to be a villain, you know, somewhere along the line. And like I said, it's a little bit self-inflicted, but you know, it is what it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now I know everyone wants to hear about the cheating, but I want to talk a little bit more about just what's going on with that, because that can't be an entire podcast, but you faced a lot of adversity in your career, and you know, everyone who's seen your stats know that there's like a few years missing and you had a lot of injuries with your arm. You're injured right now, but you're getting on that path to rehab. And what's it like rehabbing? What's it like mentally to you? Because I know for so many guys it's draining, and I know you said it on the podcast you did with Dan, but you're inching closer to that return. And how is it feeling right now? How's your arm and what do you
It's good, you know. Rehab and, you know, being injured is the worst part of it. You know, I mean, these, you know, I sprained my UCL for the first time in 2016, and it wasn't bad enough to where I needed surgery, but we knew eventually I would need surgery. So like, that's kind of hard to pitch with too. It's like, yeah, your arm's messed up and you're going to need surgery. It's just kind of a matter of when. That came in, you know, 2018. But just throughout the whole timeline from 2016 till 2018, I dealt with a lot of different injuries, probably all related back to, you know, the elbow. You know, if you have a torn ACL, a partially torn ACL, and you're a football player, like your quad's going to be messed up, your calf's going to be messed up, your feet are going to be messed up, your hips, your back, it just kind of, the list goes on. So for me with the elbow, it was just a revolving door of like, what's next? Like, what am I not going to feel good, you know, doing pitching wise, you know, next until I finally do get surgery. So that was kind of what I was dealing with in 2017. And then again in 2018, until I ultimately had the, you know, the elbow, you know, fully tear. And then I ended up by rehabbing it to pitch out of the bullpen in the postseason. Cause I felt like I could still pitch in a limited capacity, even with the injury. And I did, and I pitched okay. I pitched in the Cleveland series. I pitched in the Boston series. And then I had surgery and I missed all of 2019. And then of course, 2020, was the COVID season, but I was mostly healthy that whole season. And then, you know, last year I was mostly healthy. It was really just, you know, I re-injured the elbow in that postseason start against the White Sox, and kind of sucks because I felt like we had a really good team, a really good chance to, you know, win the World Series. You know, you never know. I could have gone out there and pitched horrible. I mean, there's always that option, but I think I was throwing the ball extremely well last season, and I think I could have made a difference. But that's just kind of part of the game, man. I'm one of those guys that unfortunately has had to deal with a lot of injuries. And it's the worst and hardest part, you know, of the game, because our timeline in the sport is small, even though it feels like a long time. You know, I'm 28 and I'm definitely probably in the back half of my career. I mean, I'm not going to play another, I don't think, another 10 years. So it's just kind of one of those things that sucks. You just have to do it. You have no choice. And, you know, I mentioned closer to getting back out there, and hopefully I can stay out there.
Yeah. And then do you have the timetable? Yeah. You think it's coming soon? Like,
yeah, I mean, it's coming soon. Like, I actually went in today to the field and threw a bullpen and talked to our trainer, and he's going to, you know, speak with, you know, the Astros, you know, the brass, as we call them, the GM and things of that nature, and, you know, get a plan going. But I would expect a rehab outing here pretty soon, and, you know, expect at least 4 to 5, you know, minor league starts, and then, you know, back in the big leagues.
Yeah, that's, I mean, everyone wants to see you back, yeah. even us Yankee fans. Unless it's not in the postseason against us, but it'll probably come at some point.
Yeah,
I'm sure it will. Yeah, Max, I know you wanted to mention some stuff. Go ahead.
Well, so like, this is like the sixth or seventh podcast we've done. This is by far the best one, but like none of the guys that we really talked to have had the experience and the stories that you have. So I want to know, like, if you have any like great stories from like a clubhouse, or if maybe someone like Garrett Cole, who I love, if you could tell us like any stories like behind the scenes, or you know, some funny stuff that goes on.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you play with these guys and you two experience a lot of life with them. I mean, we spend all the time with each other. I think probably one of my favorite Garrett Cole stories is right when we first traded for him. He was his first spring training. Me and Keuchel were living together in a little house in Jupiter, Florida. And Garrett, you know, we're still getting to know each other, feel each other out, things like that. And Garrett mentioned that he's a really good cook. And then we're like, really? He's like, oh yeah, like I'm big time cook. And we're like, okay. And so he came over and brought fish and brought all kind of wine and cooked us, I believe it was sea bass, cooked us some sea bass, full meal. It was like a Michelin star meal. There was a couple courses. He paired the wine out. So that's a cool, you know, moment. And that was a good way for Garrett to introduce himself. I think as time has gone, people know that Garrett can cook now. I mean, he's been on a cooking show or two, I believe, and it's something he talks about. But back then, I don't think he really spoke about it that much. You know, just, you know, getting to, you know, be in a rotation, you know, with the guys. I mean, our 2018 rotation was pretty phenomenal. It was Verlander, Cole, Troy Morton, Dallas Keuchel, and myself. And, you know, that was a pretty special rotation, you know, a lot of team dinners, you know, visits to Napa, you know, things of that nature. So a lot of great moments and memories that you pick up along the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, you know, as a Yankee fan, we also like the Garrett Cole stories. We haven't heard many of them yet, but hopefully there's more to come with our future guests, but that was a funny one. I like that. And now I just want to know, like, a story that you know, no one's going to be able to tell better than you because you lived it. Winning that World Series, what was that like, stepping on the field, coming out of the dugout, or were you in the pen or the dugout?
I started that game, so I was in the dugout after it was over. Yeah.
So coming out of the dugout, what was that just feeling like, and what was the wave of excitement that hit you? Like, how can you describe that?
Yeah, I mean, it's just a cool feeling of like accomplishment. You know what I mean? Like, you just, there's so much time spent. There's so, you know, many hours like put in with like the same group of guys, you know, working towards goal that everybody else is working towards. And it's almost just like this sigh of relief that, and it's a mental and physical grind, you know, getting to that point in the season and, you know, being that successful for that long. And we played the full amount of games against Boston, I believe, maybe 4 out of the 5 against Boston. We played 7 out of 7 against the Yankees, and every single game was like super close, walk off, you know, type of game, super high intensity. And then we go play the Dodgers, and, you know, again, it's like we play all 7 games, like a whirlwind. We came back against them late, you know, at their place in game 2, I believe, with that big homer by Marwin and the homers by, you know, Springer and Correa. And then game 4 or 5 at Minute Maid Park, it was the constant back and forth with all the homers and like just the emotion, just like you're just exhausted. And at that point, it's almost like a sigh of relief. It's like, we did it, and like, we can almost rest now. And honestly, it's like the World Series hangover is more of like an exhaustion hangover than anything. I remember it was like way past Christmas and I just felt tired all the time. I remember like that was like the biggest thing, like the guys talked about, coming into, spring training. It's just this like overwhelming feeling of constantly just like a little bit tired. But it's like, you don't get too much time to enjoy it because it's, November you win and then you're on the World Series tour. You're going to all these different places and, you're signing everything and you're visiting with the trophies and then before you know it, it's Christmas and then you're training and then you're back at it. So it's a very small window of time to like enjoy it, but it's like a big sense of just like relief and, then you have to kind of gear up to do it all over again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That just sounds amazing. I mean, this is very like insignificant, but my high school team just won like the regional championship that we just played. And oh my God, it was the best thing in the world. So I can only imagine what it feels like to win the World Series. Yeah. Shout out to Baruch High School. But I want to know, I know we keep saying I want to know, but this is once in a lifetime opportunity to talk to a great major league pitcher, but like favorite matchups or, who do you think is like the hardest to get out in your opinion?
I mean, it just depends. Like my favorite matchups, of course, I love going against guys, the best in the league. Like I love pitching against Trout and in spring training, I get to face Soto quite a bit. I mean, we don't face him a lot during the actual season, but I've been able to face guys that I've, played travel ball with and I've, gotten to actually play against guys that I played in high school with, same team, guys I grew up with, I'm playing with one of them. I mean, Tucker is a couple years younger than me, but both from Tampa, Florida, a lot of Tampa, Florida guys, around the big leagues. But I think the hardest guy for me to get out individually, just like numbers wise, for sure, it's been Salvador Perez. The numbers are ugly. He's got quite a few homers off me, a postseason homer off me, a lot of damage and, facing guys that I grew up admiring and wanting to be like, such as like Robinson Cano, facing him when he used to play for Seattle for the first couple times, mm-hmm. was kind of an out of this world experience for young Lance. My second start in the big leagues, I pitched against, Miggy Cabrera and, Cespedes and Nick Castellanos, who I played against in high school in a state championship. He's from Miami. I'm from Tampa, Florida. So, it's just pretty wild. You face these guys. I faced Ian Kinsler that game. So I grew up watching Ian Kinsler, play with the Rangers and, win pennants and things of that nature. So those first few starts or that first year, especially, is pretty wild because you're growing up watching these guys, idolizing these guys. And then as soon, before you know it, you're facing them and it's your job to get them out. And, you realize you're just kind of, you're in the moment. You're part of, Major League Baseball. And I think those are like the moments that kind of hit you and you realize like, it's not so much the stadiums or the amenities, but it's like facing those guys you grew up admiring is like when you really realize like, damn, like I'm in the big leagues.
Yeah. And just something that I kind of wanted to ask a question, like you're welcome to the majors moment, but you kind of got there. So now what was it like when you find, so I guess you were a first round pick 41, and you were committed to Florida, but obviously you signed. And then coming up through the minors, were there moments where you were like, I'm ready to just be in the major? Like what was that come up like? Cause it was pretty short. You were in the minors for only 2 years.
Yeah. I signed late after my first year. So I didn't have much time that first season, pitched a couple of innings like in GCL and then went to, instructional league. My first really full season was 2013. I pitched in the Midwest League. I started the All-Star game in the Midwest League. I actually faced a guy I played with growing up. His name is Jesse Winker. He's now with the Seattle Mariners. We played together on the same AAU team, growing up. He's from Orlando. So I faced him in that game and then had a really good season, went to high A the following year, had a really bad season in high A, pitched in the California League, pitched really, really poorly. Like, I'm not sure baseball is like the right thing for me type of pitch. And went into that off season, worked really hard, got back with like, you know, my pitching coach and kind of back where I wanted to be. And then 2015, my third full season, went to double A for like 2 or 3 weeks. And I remember in spring training, I was facing some big league guys in some backfields, and I really felt like I was like overpowering them. And I felt like my command was starting to tick up a little bit. I was starting to, you know, get pretty crisp as far as my third off-speed pitch goes and things of that nature. And I kind of thought to myself in those moments, I'm like, I think I may be ready for the big leagues. And then I got invited to the preseason game where it's like outside of spring training, right before the season starts, like a little exhibition game. We faced the Royals, and I was facing some of like the normal guys for the Royals, and I was handling them. And I was like, I think I'm ready for the big leagues. And I pitched like 2 or 3 weeks in double A, and they called me up, and that was it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That has to be surreal just to, you know, kind of a lot of guys, some of these guys go through the minors for like 6-7 years and then finally get that call up, and you got there very fast. And then obviously, you know, the rest is history. You succeeded in the major. Yeah.
I got like one more story and then I got to run, but it's funny how things happen, man. Like, you know, I was with the Astros. Obviously we didn't have a great team at that point. And the Astros were dedicated to building from within. And then they had a couple of high draft picks for a couple of years in a row. And those draft picks, myself included, were starting to, you know, reach double A, reach triple A, start getting close to that big league level. And in 2015, we got out of the gates hot, probably playing a little bit over our ceiling that season to get right out of the gates, but got out of the gates hot. And I remember there was like a Tops auction, like a random Tops auction that you like entered online. And this kid won it from Georgia, and it was to be a minor league baseball player for the day, you know, come to the stadium, have your own locker, take BP, the whole thing. And Corpus Christi just so happened, that's where I was playing double A. They just so happened like win the bid. It wasn't even a win the bid. They were assigned the bid. They probably didn't even want to like host it. And the Astros owned it at the time, and Nolan Ryan worked for us. So the Astros sent Nolan Ryan to the stadium, like 3 hours from Houston, to like do the interview and meet this guy for some publicity. You know, we weren't really that big of a team, like not a big like marketing team. So I'm sure the Astros are trying to, you know, do something nice, get in the news a little bit. Mm-hmm. So Nolan's there with this kid who won this random auction, and we had to host, and I'm throwing a bullpen that day. And our old pitching coach, Doug Borkowski, knew Nolan Ryan, pitched like 20 years in the big leagues, and told him, hey, you got to come see this kid throw a bullpen. And it was me. And so Nolan comes over and kind of watches from the background. And I knew Nolan was there, and man, it was one of the best bullpens I've ever thrown. And on the way back from Corpus that next day, he called Jeff Luno, our GM, and said, hey, like, if you're serious about winning this year, because it was kind of getting to that point where they thought, hey, maybe we could make a little bit of a run type of thing. And they said, hey, if you're serious about winning, you should call this Mccullers kid up. And then like 2 days later, one of the big league starters went down with the blister. And so they were like, screw it. Like, we'll call Mccullers up and give him a couple games, see what he's got. I pitched 3 games. I pitched excellent. And when they were going to option me, one of our other pitchers got hurt. He hurt his knee and was going to be out for a couple months. And so they let me stay in the rotation. And then I stayed. So it's kind of weird how that happened. It was a fortunate thing, and took advantage of the opportunity.
Yeah. And that's a great way to end this podcast. For sure. I know, cause you got to run. But anything else that you'd want to say to anyone watching, advice? Cause our audience is mainly like, I'd say like, you know, 14, 18 year olds, but a lot of baseball players looking to get, you know, hopefully play next level. And then a lot of people just watching to watch, but anything you want to say?
No, I would just say, you know, work hard, you know, try to be, you know, the best version of yourself can be, and you know, that's it.
All right. Thank you so much, Lance. Appreciate you for coming on. This was a once in a lifetime experience. Definitely going to see you again when you're back in Yankee Stadium. You know, we'll be at the game for sure. Got to see you throw one day. But
all right, guys. Well, I'll see you in the postseason. I expect you guys to boo me fully.
All right.
All right.
I won't boo you. I might boo. I'm never going to boo you again.
No, that's good.
I mean, hey, if you ask, we might. Yeah. All right.
All right, guys. I'll see you.
Thank you so much. See you.
Thank you. No, I'm just, you know, it's great how like just like the little steps that we've taken. You know, the first ever Aiden's World of Sports was just me. It was just me and him like a year ago. And just in a year, we have Lance Mccullers on the podcast. It's kind of crazy, but I definitely just like and support the video. I mean, that's really it.
Before I cut the cameras, everyone go follow and subscribe to DSARM on YouTube. Go follow him on Instagram.
Yeah, thank you.
Shout out, Dan. Thank you so much. Dan got me in touch with Lance. I'll put it up on the screen right now. We met at the Yankee game just a month ago. And from a month of just, you know, going on the field and getting his autograph, and, you know, I was, like, nervous. You know, it was a surprise. I was really nervous. I didn't expect it. To having Lance on for, you know, that was, like, a 45-minute conversation about some of his best stories in the big leagues. It's just surreal. It's surreal to see how far me and Max have come in this journey. And, I mean, it's not going to stop, man. We'll see you back for the next Batter's Eye podcast. Thank you for the support. Subscribe, leave a like, comment, and we'll see you next time. Peace.